Mark and Mary had two twin children. Angel was an amazing young man. He always did what he was told. If mom or dad asked him to clean his room, do the dishes, or take out the trash, there was never as much as an argument, never a reply, other than yes, sir, or yes, ma'am. He was the kind of child that every single parent dreamt of having. Other parents would brag on him all the time. The family went to church every single Sunday. Whenever there was a new student that came to check out what the youth group was all about, Angel was the go-to student. Angel even preached from time to time and was training to go into ministry. All of the girls at church loved Angel, but he chose to stay focused on what mattered to him most, what was most important, ministry training. He was invited to party after party, but he never went. Those were all bad things for him to get involved with, he thought. They were things that would try to tempt him and take him away from what God truly had in store for him. You see, Angel was an exceptional student and athlete. He was a star quarterback on the football field and a star student in the classroom. He was in all college level classes his senior year of high school. He had received scholarship after scholarship to go to college and play football, whether it was Mizzou, University of Iowa, or even Alabama. Every college wanted him, but he chose to give it up. He knew since his freshman year of high school that he was going to go into ministry. Scholarships, parties, fame, and success never really interested him. The only thing he wanted to do was please the Lord and please his family. And he just knew that he was going to do a great job at both. Damon was a different story. He was always a bit of a troublemaker throughout school. He always talked back to mom and dad about any kind of chore. And even if he didn't talk back, there was always the occasional and ah and fine. Damon was no star athlete and certainly no star student. He never played sports in school, and he did all of the on-level classes in school and barely made it by in those. Something that Damon was really good at, though, was business. He knew how to operate a business very, very well. He knew all about supply and demand. He knew all about return on investment and loans and how to give just enough of a sample to have someone hooked. He was great at marketing. Did I mention that he learned all of this by selling drugs? If you wanted or needed anything, Damon was your guy. Damon went to church with his family. It was always the best hour of sleep that he got during the week. A lot of the girls at church loved Damon too, just for slightly different reasons. He was certainly not the one that met the new students. You see, often the youth pastor tried to help students steer clear of him. He was a huge troublemaker. He had been picked up early multiple times from the youth group for causing problems, whether it was vaping in the bathroom, talking too loudly during the service, or just being a nuisance at any point. He was always invited to every party too, just like his brother, but he definitely always went. Business was always good at parties. He could count on a handful of the athletes to want to get some speed. He could always count on one or two of the cheerleaders who were in their rebellious phase to buy a joint or two. He never told them it was just oregano. Why not save money where I can? He always thought. It's not like they ever knew any better. The two twins lived completely different lives. Often the parents questioned how they could possibly be related. They knew for a fact that Angel was their son, because why would someone question that? It was Damon that they were truly worried about. Did they give us the wrong kid? Mark would often ask. No, of course they didn't. was always Mary's response. Are you sure? Angel has nice blonde hair, just like ours. Damon's is really dark. It's almost black, said Mark. Stop, Mark. You know we let him dye it, said Mary shortly. Fair point, said Mark. After they graduated, Angel with an impressive 4.0 and Damon with an impressive 1.2, they were off to their futures. Angel was planning on going straight into an official internship at his church. Damon was off to Vegas. Huge shocker. Angel stayed home while going through his internship. He worked very hard at the church. They gave him a very well-rounded schedule. He would get to preach, teach at youth group, go on the youth trips, do a little bit of children's ministry, and he had one of the elders disciple him throughout the whole internship. His sermons were improving. His ability to lead the youth was amazing. The kids loved working with him. And the elders found him to be a great young man. Outside of church, he continued to help his mom and dad around the house. Again, he never talked back, never gave an excuse, never tried to get out of the chores either. Always gave a simple yes, ma'am, or yes, sir. He would take out the trash, he would do the dishes, he would cut the grass, and whatever else his family needed done. Between helping at home and his internship, there wasn't a whole lot of time for enjoying the summer. Although he never complained about anything out loud, he was always frustrated with Damon. He was upset that Damon never tried anything. He knew how much potential Damon truly had, and he always hated that he never really tapped into it. He couldn't stand that his brother was into dealing drugs and most of the church knew about it. He always felt like his brother was a dark spot on his family's clean record. How could the two of them be twins and yet be so different? How could he take ministry, family, and life so seriously, and yet his brother would be so foolish? One night he saw his mom and dad in the kitchen. They were sitting there at the table praying, like they did every night. They prayed for a lot of things. They prayed over their finances. They prayed for their church. They prayed for their pastor and youth pastor, and the other church leaders too. They said a quick prayer thanking God for Angel. But the longest part of their prayer was for Damon. They wouldn't stop asking and begging God to bring him home and to bring Damon to God. They prayed for him to be humbled and brought to his knees. They prayed for his safety and for his well-being while he was gone. All I get is a quick sentence of gratitude, he thought. If you have your Bibles, turn with me to Luke chapter 15. We're going to be looking at a parable that Jesus tells that many of you are likely familiar with. We're going to see a similar story of two sons in one household. One is the star child, the one that every parent wishes they had. And the other, a little bit of a troublemaker. Verse 11 says this, we can go ahead and put this up. He also said, a man had two sons. The younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the share of the estate I have coming to me. So he distributed the assets to him. Not many days later, the younger son gathered together all he had and traveled to a distant country where he squandered his estate in foolish living. After he had spent everything, a severe famine struck that country and he had nothing. Then he went to work for citizens of that country, who sent him into his field to feed pigs. He longed to eat his fill from the pods that the pigs were eating, but no one would give him anything. When he came to his senses, he said, "How many of my father's hired workers have more than enough food? And here I am, dying of hunger. I'll get up, go to my father, and say to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and in your sight. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired workers.'" So he got up and went to his father. But while the son was still a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion. He ran, threw his arms around his neck, and kissed him. The son said to him, "Father, I have sinned against heaven and in your sight. I am no longer worthy to be called your son." I want to pause there. In this story that Jesus tells, there are two sons. One son goes to his father and says, "I want my share of the inheritance now." In this day and age and in this culture that Jesus is talking to, what that meant is that this son went to his father and said, "You might as well be dead to me. You are dead to me. So give me what is mine now. I want it now." This was not exactly like what many of us have maybe done. I know I definitely have, where I call up mom, call up dad, ask to borrow some money, you know, want to go out with my friends. That's not what this is. This son wants what's been already left to him in his father's will. This would be as if you went to your parents and said, "I know you've drafted a will. You're dead to me anyway. Give to me whatever you left to me." The father's reply is interesting. You see, while the father could have very easily said no, the father was still living, he gives to his son what would have been left had he died. And we're told that the son goes off and lives in reckless, wild, extravagant living. As a little bit of a spoiler alert, the older brother will maybe tell us a little bit of what all went on in the life of that young man. The young man comes to a very dire situation. He's gone off to this distant land, and he's looking to establish himself and just have a good time, and famine strikes, and he finds himself hungry. He is starving, looking for anything he can eat, looking for any kind of job that will provide him with some money, and he takes this interesting job of working with pigs. The reason Jesus is telling these people this is that pigs were a big no-no. You couldn't be around pigs, you couldn't touch pigs, you couldn't work with pigs if you're a good Jewish person. This man is at the lowest point he could possibly be. And even at his lowest, he is still hungry. He sees the slop that the pigs eat and longs to even eat that, but is told that even that is off limits. This is a very low point. And as this young man gathers his wits, as he starts to maybe have some mental clarity, he recognizes that even the servants in his father's house are well fed and treated better than he is. So he comes up with this plan. He's going to go home to his dad after telling him that he's dead. After telling him that you're dead to me, he's going to go to that father and say, I'm no longer worthy to be your son, but maybe you could just hire me. If you could just hire me, that would be more than enough for me. So he goes to his father. And I can kind of picture this playing out in this way. His father is maybe a little bit of an older man. I don't know how true this is. We're not really told, but just bear with me and Richard's imagination for a second. He's an older man, a little hard of sight, a little bit feeble, doesn't get around as well as he used to, which is why he has all these hired workers. It's also why his sons would work for him. He's getting a little older. And even in this older age, and with everything that has happened to his son, he still recognizes him. He recognizes his son off in a distance, despite the brokenness, the lost weight, and the ragged clothes. And he knows exactly who that person is. It's his son. His father is filled with compassion, and he runs to his son, who said, it would be better off if you were dead and out of my life. And he throws his arms around him and kisses him on his face, on his neck. And he just holds and embraces the son who walked away. This is what happens next. Verse 22, it says this. But the father told his servants, quick, bring out the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Then bring the fattened calf and slaughter it, and let's celebrate with a feast. Because this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. And so they began to celebrate. What an interesting response from a loving father. I've never been a father. I don't know if you know that. Some of you have, some of you never will, you know? But I can imagine that in my own human pride and brokenness, that if I had experienced the kind of hatred that this father had received, I don't know how easy it would be to take a child back like that. I don't know if you've ever thought about that. I've seen some broken father-son relationships. I've seen some of the devastation that can take place within those. And what I know is that so many times we tell ourselves we would be just like this father until that moment comes. And we let some of that bitterness and that anger build up within ourselves. And rather than responding with celebration that our lost child has returned home and wants to be a part of our family again, has humbled himself to be with us again, oftentimes I think that in our own human brokenness, we still look to reject. I tell you the truth, friends. That's not our loving Father in heaven. The father in this story is meant to resemble the Father in heaven. This son resembles those who have walked away from the Father. And when they feel as if they are not even good enough to be in the presence of Jesus, when they are not even good enough to be in the presence of their Father, the Heavenly Father comes and wraps them in his arms, wraps them in his love, and welcomes them home. Places a ring on their finger. This ring is a signet ring. It's not just a normal ring. This ring symbolizes a place in the family that you belong here. And a celebration ensues. We talked a little bit about that last week when we looked at some of the other parables. You see, all of these parables kind of go hand in hand. The same celebration that takes place in this story is the celebration that we talked about last week amongst the angels and the hosts of heaven that rejoice when one sinner repents, when one son comes home. But there's an interesting part of the story that takes place that we don't see in the two before this. Says this in verse 25, and we can put that up. Now his older son was in the field. As he came near the house, he heard music and dancing. So he summoned one of the servants, questioning what these things meant. Your brother is here, he told him, and your father has slaughtered the fattened calf because he has him back safe and sound. Then he became angry and didn't want to go in. So his father came out and pleaded with him. But he replied to his father, look, I have been slaving for you many years, and I have never, ever disobeyed your orders. Yet you never gave me a goat so that I could celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours came, who has devoured your assets with prostitutes, you slaughtered the fattened calf for him. That's a pretty fair response from the older son. Could you agree? Imagine you have always done what is right in your life, and when somebody who does wrong gets better treatment, you look and you say, that's not fair. Maybe you don't necessarily experience this within church, but maybe if you just look out and you look at the world around you, you see the prosperity of those who hurt others, those who do wrong, those who have hurt you. And you look at their lives and they just seem to be better than yours. And you can't help but think, how is this fair? That's what this brother feels. I want to be transparent with you. Something that I have often wrestled with in my life has been identifying with this older brother. That's something that I've always had to fight in my life. Many of you may know, and if you don't, well, you will now. I was pretty much born and raised in church. I wasn't actually born in church, but I feel like it was pretty close. I always went to church. I was always in youth group. I always went to all of the Bible studies. I always tried to serve. I would be at the service projects. I would go on the mission trips. I always strived to do what was right. And I've seen many, many people who have gone and done their own thing. They walked away from God. They got to live the fun life. And I was stuck with the boring church stuff.
Hallelujah.
Some of you who have been the son, you probably know it's not as fun as it may seem. But I've always wrestled with that. When people who have gone and done the fun thing and come to Christ later, and they get the same reward that I do. They get the kingdom of heaven just like me. And I wish I could say that every single time I have been the father or the servants who rejoice. But that would be a lie. There have been times where I've seen people come to Christ and I can't help but be jealous. In my head, how come you get to have the best of both worlds? And it really comes down to, what do we value more? The thing that I've had to wrestle with most regarding that is, do I value the things of God more than I value the things of the world? And in those situations, the answer is no. And I have to refocus my mind. Yeah. That the things that seem fun are the things that God warns us about, and He warns us about them for a reason. It's not just to keep us away from what's fun. It's a way to protect us. Oftentimes when this parable is preached about, the emphasis is always on the son that strayed. It's an image of those who have walked away. You can come to Christ, you can come to God, and He'll always embrace you. And while that's true, that's the main focus of the two parables before. But if you remember from last week, the people who these messages are truly for are the Pharisees who are judging the sinners and the tax collectors that are there to listen to Jesus. This story is very much so about them and their hearts, because they've looked at the people who have strayed and said, they are not worthy to be loved by God. That is not a condemnation that you and I are qualified to make. Yeah. And unfortunately, it's one that I've made a couple of times. And it takes time and effort and a lifetime of learning to consistently refocus that God loves His children. Picking up in verse 31, this is what it says. The father gives a response to this son who's angry. Son, he said to him, you are always with me, and everything I have is yours. But we had to celebrate and rejoice, because this brother of yours was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is now found. The father wants to correct the heart of the older brother. He wants him to see his brother the same way that he sees him. And it's in love. Not anger and frustration about what has happened prior to this point. Just a simple celebration that one who was lost is now found. And this conclusion of this story brings us to our point today. It's this. We can put that up. God loves His children. All of them. God loves his children, every single one. God loves the child who strayed, and God loves the child who stayed. It doesn't matter how long you've been in the church. It doesn't matter how long you have been a Christian or a follower of Christ. It does not matter how long that has been. God loves you the same. The love he has for you is no different from the love he has for me. It does not matter what you've done. It does not matter what you haven't done. God loves you. And God loves me. Because he loves all of his children. One day, Damon came home. His clothes were raggedy. He had just had enough money for a bus pass to get him home. He had gambled away a lot of his money. He thought that there was no real problem. He would just sell more drugs. But he got caught with the wrong kind of people. He had been mugged, and all of the drugs he was selling were stolen. Drug dealers are not too forgiving when it comes to stolen merchandise. When his dad saw him, he came to him and hugged him. His mom followed suit with tears streaming down her face. They took him inside and heard about all he had been through. His mom fetched a towel fresh out of the dryer, which Angel had loaded, and turned the shower on. While Damon showered, his dad went into his room and pulled out some of the clothes that he had left behind when he had left everything else behind. Angel came in from mowing the lawn to see what was going on. His mom had told him everything. Damon got out of the shower, and his dad came up with an amazing idea. Summer was coming to an end, and the window for travel was closing. Things were about to start getting busy again. What if we planned a family trip? Maybe a nice cruise through the Caribbean. We will pay for everything. Dad, are you serious right now? Angel asked. I have been here all summer. I have worked at the church. I have preached. I have gone on trips with the kids. I watched all of those little brats for a whole week. I have mowed the lawn without ever speaking against you. Mom, I have always done the dishes and taken out the trash when you asked. I have never given y'all grief for a single thing in my whole life. And now this drug dealer comes home after spending all of his money at casinos and on drugs, and suddenly we want to plan a family trip? He has never acted like a part of the family. But I'm supposed to just pretend that it doesn't matter? Son, his father started. I can understand why you are frustrated. It doesn't seem fair to you that you have always done what's right and your brother has not. The reason I want to do this is because your brother realizes his mistakes. This is a moment that we have now to be a family. Whole, complete, unbroken. It is a time to celebrate your brother's decision to rejoin our family. It's not because he deserves it. It's because we love him and want him to know that he is loved. You don't have to go with us, but we want to celebrate your brother choosing to turn his life around, and we would love to have him come with us. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I thank you for this day that you've given us. God, I thank you for the parable of the prodigal son. God, I thank you for the twofold message. God, that those who are lost, those who have walked away, they can join your family. And you welcome them with open arms. But God, I also thank you for the warning that goes out to those of us who often feel like the older brother. God, I pray that we would humble our hearts. God, that when somebody comes home, rather than being upset that they get the same reward in your kingdom, God, that we would rejoice that it's another person who's saved. God, I pray for those right now who feel as if they have walked away and they wonder if they can ever come back. God, I thank you that you always welcome us. And God, I pray that for those of us who have been doing this for a long time, I pray we would always rejoice and celebrate those who make it home. God, we love you and we thank you for your son and his sacrifice that he made on that cross so that we can come home. And God, it's in his name we pray. Amen. As per usual, this will be the time of invitation. If you have any prayer requests that you would like to lift up, any decisions that you would like to make, this will be the time to do so as the band comes and leads us in one final song.